We're here live, Ontario Open, and we're here with Showdown Joe. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So this is my first time interviewing someone who talks on camera, a personality in the sport. So I'm kind of nervous, actually, more than I would a fighter per se.
Don't be nervous. Don't be nervous at all. Don't be nervous.
Can you? I see you're wearing the Gringo Jiu-Jitsu yep. shirt. Let us know. Your background in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, perhaps.
I started training Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu in 1996. My original instructors are here, Sil and Dan Maroney. They gave me some pretty big big bear hugs. Well, not so much Sil. Sil's a smaller one, but Danny, when Danny hugs you, it's not good. All my old teammates are here, Antonio Carvalho, Justin Bruckman, Marco, Alicia, Marco Costa, Richard Nanku, all the old guys are here from the old days. And Gringo, it's part of the family, and it was actually Justin Bruckman who told me, listen, we know you want to get back in because I take so much time. I'm traveling a lot. But you got to go to Gringo's, and that's the bottom line. I paid one visit to Gringo. Before you know it, I was on the mats, brought my gi, and, I'm starting. For me, I'm starting from scratch, But I want to come out with my white belt. He's like, no, you put your blue belt on. So I think my goal is to get to purple belt as soon as possible. But, I just, right when you came over to grab me, I was talking to Antonio Carvalho, who's fighting in July, and he said, we're going to work on this. We're going to work on that. We'll get you your purple, but you got to put your time in. So I'm going to put my time in for sure.
So we're looking around at this huge venue. You said you started in 1996.
Yeah.
Let's go back. What was 1996 like? How many people would be here right now?
I remember when the Samurai guys with Moni Azik and Carlos Newton and Omar Salvosa at the time, and we were the Grappling Arts Academy, when they would have tournaments, they were big, but it was about maybe, I don't want to be wrong, but perhaps 40% of what we're seeing right now. Like, I mean, and then when I was holding tournaments in 2002 and 2004, I was maybe half of this, if that. On a good day, I was half. When I walked in here, I actually walked upstairs, and you can see the glass out there. My eyes were just like, wow. I mean, there are MMA promoters that would die to have this many people, let alone competitors, at their events. So, Gringo and the guys, Fernando Zulik, and they're doing an amazing job putting this on, and I'm blown away. So, I'm joking that I got a hall pass from the wife, and there's Gringo right there, the guy putting it on. So I gotta watch. He should never take my back. That's not a good thing. Him taking my back, but the stuff that he's doing, putting this on, is unbelievable. So I'm very proud of him, and I can learn from that. And I've been around this game for a long time, so good for him.
You covering the UFC now a lot. Do you find that the sport has becoming a lot of stand-up, obviously? But do you miss seeing the groundwork that we did see in the earlier days of the UFC?
I first started kickboxing and boxing and a little bit of wrestling before I fell in love with jiu-jitsu. And jiu-jitsu is always number one in my heart. Well, I should say MMA is number one in my heart, but jiu-jitsu, the submission game, is so important to me. When I see a guy like, Damian Maia or Paul Harris or guys that are defeating the jiu-jitsu game, it shows that they're getting much, much better. But the submissions is what I truly miss, because that's what got me in there. When I first saw Royce Gracie in 93 doing what he was doing to the Shamrocks of the world, and then in 94 continuing to do that, and then when he fought Severin, getting his butt kicked, and then 17 or 14 minutes later, he pulls off the triangle choke. I remember, what is this triangle choke? I got to learn this, right? That's how I fell in love with the sport, and it's what I miss, but it's the evolution of mixed martial arts. Submissions will come back in a more dominant fashion. It's just that it's a different way to execute it. I mean, you look at what happened with Paul Harris. He was so focused on working that submission. Before you know it, there comes Belcher with that elbow. It changes the dynamics of the game. So it's up to the jiu-jitsu guys now to evolve, to bring the jiu-jitsu and the submissions back into mixed martial arts. It's a sport now where you have to know how to box, kickbox, Muay Thai, judo, wrestling, submissions. You have to know it all. But if you want to dominate in one portion, then it's up to you or your camp or whomever to take that to the next level. And I think it's going to happen.
Absolutely. You mentioned the Belcher throwing in his elbows. His MMA helped make his jiu-jitsu look even better, correct?
100%. 100%.
Do you find Paul Harris was a little bit confused, though, when he had some of the 10th Planet stuff going on?
I don't know if he was confused, or more or less he stopped thinking. He was reacting more than he was thinking. That 10th Planet stuff is ridiculous. I'll watch some of the stuff that online, and I'm like, Can I pull that off in class? Because that looks amazing. I think what happened is, and again, neither one of us know because we're not the one getting elbowed or punched in the face. We're not the one going for that leg lock. We're not the one getting drilled in the skull. It's a completely different game when you're in there. But based on what I saw from an analytic point of view, I think he stopped thinking and was reacting. And in that very moment, and Chael Sonnen, I'm reading Chael Sonnen's book right now. He talks about his wrestling instructor, and it's something we learn in life. The one moment, the one momentary lapse when you stop, focus, next thing you know, you're in a triangle choke, and as opposed to defeating Anderson Silva, your brain stopped moving. It's called the putting your hand on that hot stove, right? Mm-hmm. People say, oh, that momentary lapse. Put your hand on a hot stove for 1 second. Tell me what that one millisecond feels like. It's the same thing. I think Paul Harris, it looked to me like he stopped thinking. Part of it could have been that elbow, could have been the submissions, could have been, or the defense, could have been anything. 1 second, and you stop thinking in mixed martial arts, over quickly.
Nice. And any last words, upcoming events for you, things you want to tell people about jiu-jitsu if they're not involved and this is their first time perhaps maybe witnessing it or just even seeing it in the background?
I'm going to be all over the place over the next couple of months. I think I'm leaving for Vegas in a couple of weeks. I'm trying to do a whack of charity stuff. People are always like, why don't you just pick one charity? Well, why would I want to pick one charity unless I create my own? That's something I'll think about in the future. I'm doing a whole bunch of Walk a Mile for Autism. I'm doing a bunch of breast cancer stuff, other cancer, you know, raising money and stuff like that. I'm trying to take advantage of what you guys call the celebrity mm-hmm. and putting my time in there. I'm going to try and bring my son with me all the time. I want him to grow up and say, you know what, when you have time, go and do this stuff. You know, and at the same time, the grappling scene to me, the amateur grassroots, mixed martial arts, it's so important. And I tell the story 1,000 times. I'll never stop telling the story. You know, this is where George St. Pierre came from. You know, I remember George St. Pierre competing in stuff like this. And I remember him being in the dressing room scared to compete. Look at him now. You know, this is where they come from. And this is where Sidney Crosby, when he played hockey, you know, Timbits hockey and stuff like that. You never know who you're going to see. That's why I tell people, just come out. It's $10, man. It's $10 to put in the pockets of the promoter and get these guys the ability to compete. You never know who's going to come up. Above all, you never know who you're going to meet. Antonio Carvalho's here. Yeah. Justin Brugman. You got Carlos Newton, the very first UFC welterweight champion for Canada. He's roaming around here. You never know. What, 3 hours, 4 hours on a Sunday? Come out and support. Give your love. You know, if I can do it, you can do it. Come on, man. Like, I mean, who am I to say I'm better than anyone? I'm not. I'm in town. I want to do it. Now, if I was traveling and I was in Vegas or covering the UFC, I can't do it. But when I'm in town, you got to do it. That's why I'm telling people all the time, come out and support. You never know. Plus, you might just sign up and start training jits somewhere. So do it.
I love it. And before we leave, let people know how they could see you, your show, and maybe find out some more info about you.
Thank you, man. I appreciate that. UFC Central airs on Sportsnet right across the country. Mondays, usually around 11:30, it goes into full replay. Tuesday to Sunday, it's also available online at sportsnet.ca/MMA. More information on me, go to Sportsnet. Showdown.ca is my website. Above all, you can check me out on Twitter, @ShowdownJoe. And my Facebook, I'm posting a lot of the pictures that I'm doing with the seminar. I got lazy for a while and stopped realizing how important Facebook was. I just started using Twitter. I'll be posting as many pictures as I can with all the seminars and training and all the different events that I'm going to UFC. I'll put it on my Facebook for you guys to see and to laugh at. So, yeah, we'll have a good time.
All right, guys, support Jiu-Jitsu, support Showdown Joe, the BJJ Addict. Thank you very much.